cross. It was meant to horrify the world. It was meant for humiliation. It was meant to last for days. It was meant for slow asphyxiation. It was meant to prolong torture. It was the Roman soldier's job. It was meant to be used by Caesar, but instead, it was used by God. It was meant to stop a movement, but instead, it became the way. It was meant to act on fear, but instead, it awakened faith. It was meant to be vicious and violent, but instead, it became our peace. It was meant to uproot hope, but instead, it became the seed. It was meant to punish captives, but instead, it unleashed freedom. It was meant to build up Rome, but instead, it built God's kingdom. It was meant to discourage rebels. It was meant to stop insurrection. It was meant to put down Jesus, but instead, it set up his resurrection. It was meant to jeer and mock him, but instead, it was his glory. It was meant to erase a chapter, but instead, it became the story. It was meant to hold up convicts, but instead, it raised up a king. It was meant to shut our mouth, but instead, it's why we sing. It was meant to be a judgment, but instead, it became our mercy. It's why the song of heaven is the Lamb. The Lamb is worthy. It was meant to kill an enemy, crush dissenters and diversion, but instead, it became the banner of God's love for every person. It was meant to be appalling, nailing hands and feet to wood. It was meant to be used for evil, but instead, it was used for good. It was meant to be a symbol of God's assassination, but instead, it became the symbol of Jesus' invitation. Come to the cross. Instead of sin and stain, you are meant to be made clean. Instead of being forgotten, you are meant to know your sin. Instead of being ashamed, you can leave behind your guilt. Instead of feeling empty, you were meant to be fulfilled. Instead of being broken, you are meant to be made whole. Here, Calvary is calling. It beckons you. Behold, come to the cross. Instead of being an accident, you have a purpose and a plan. Instead of being abandoned, you were chosen by his hand. For all who've said I can't, God has said I can. No matter what you've done, the invitation stands. Come to the cross. Instead of being doubtful, you are meant to know your Father. You are meant to be his son, and you are meant to be his daughter. You were cherished from the start. You were always in the picture. Instead of being a victim, you were meant to be a victor. The result of Jesus' blood, salvation has arrived. Instead of being dead, you are meant to be alive. The cross. It was meant to signal death, but instead, it's a sign of living. It was meant to be the end, but instead, it's our beginning.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified?
Where angels angels drop when you kiss your little baby. You kiss the face of God, oh Mary, did you know?
Ooh, 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 ooh.
The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again, the lame will leap, the dumb will speak, and the praise.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? The sleeping child you're holding is the great.
He who was before there was light walked across the pages of time. He who made every living thing, behold him. He who heard humanity's cry left his throne to wake as a child. He became like the least of us. Behold him.
Jesus, Son of God, Messiah, the Lamb, the roaring lion. Oh, be still and behold him.
Receive all praise. the Savior alone carried the cross for all of my sin. He paid the cost. Salvation complete. Now forever I'm free. Calvary covers it all.
Says it all, doesn't it? Calvary covers it all. I was a little concerned about that video initially because of the graphicness of it. But I gotta be honest that I think it's important for us to understand the graphicness of what Jesus did for us. And so today we're having a service of darkness. So as you can tell, it's a little dark in here. When we wrap up today, we're not going to, it's not a time of fellowship. When we wrap up today, we're gonna get up, and obviously, I mean, if someone has something that God's wrenching you with and you need to talk, obviously, yes, but you know me, right? And I'm normally a talker. I'm not going to be a talker at the end of this service, and I don't want you to be a talker at the end of this service either. The service is a deeper, it's a harder service. And I want, when we leave here today, when this message is done, these candles are out, I want us to go home. I want us to think. I want us to contemplate what the people 2,000 years ago thought and contemplated. I want us to understand what they went through when they were there. And I think that so many of us, we fail to see that. We don't get it. This is called Good Friday. And we might have that question, why is it Good Friday? What's so good about it? Our Savior was murdered on this day. Our Savior, he was killed. He was put on the cross this day. So what makes it so good? Shouldn't it be Bad Friday? And I think we should just drop one of the O's and call it God Friday. Because it was a good Friday, because you know what? It was a good Friday because what Jesus did, he willingly did. He was not killed. He was not murdered. He was sacrificed, and he volunteered to sacrifice himself for you and for me. He volunteered to go to that cross, to go through what you just saw in that last video. He volunteered to do that because he loves us so very much. He loves us so much that he didn't want us to end up in eternity in hell. So instead, he said he would go to the cross for you and for me. He chose to be sacrificed as the perfect sacrifice, the perfect lamb for you and for I, so that our sins can be washed clean as snow. Tonight we're going to walk through Luke 22, and we're also going to, Luke 22 and also Psalms 22. And so we're going to look at those tonight, and we're going to, 22 and 23 in Luke, and we're going to look at the crucifixion. We're going to walk through this, okay? And so as we do that, we're going to, a little by little, it's going to get darker and darker, just like on that day when Jesus was crucified. As the day progressed, it got stormier and stormier. It got darker and darker. And as he died on that cross, it became pitch black for so many of his followers. For all of his followers, they didn't know what to do, right? And so we're going to look at some of that. And so if you would, please join me as we go before the cross. Dear Lord, thank you so very much. Thank you for, thank you for Holy Week. Thank you for your son going to this cross for us. We don't deserve it. We never have. We never could. We don't deserve it at all. Yet he loved us. You loved us so much. You were willing to sacrifice your son on the cross for us. He was willing to be sacrificed on the cross for us. And Father, tonight as we look at this message, as we look at the scriptures on what happened to him, Father, I ask that you help us open our hearts, help us to feel what Mary and John and all of them that were there, what they felt, what the disciples who had abandoned him even felt. Father, we ask that you just do a work in us tonight, a work, that special work that you have in mind for us tonight. And lead us and guide us through this message, dear Lord. And Lord, we come to you with the prayer that your son taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. We're going to read Luke 22, starting at verse 31, and we're going to go through Luke 23, verse 56. And so starting at verse 31, Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift all of you as wheat. This is Jesus speaking. But I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers. But he replied, Lord, I am ready to go with you to prison and to death. Jesus answered, I tell you, Peter, before the rooster crows today, you will deny three times that you know me. Then Jesus asked them, when I sent you without purse, bag, or sandals, did you lack anything? Nothing, they answered. He said to them, but now if you have a purse, take it, and also a bag. And if you don't have a sword, sell your cloak and buy one. It is written, and he was numbered with the transgressors. And I tell you that this must be fulfilled in me. Yes, what is written about me is reaching its fulfillment. The disciples said, see, Lord, here are two swords. That's enough, he replied. Jesus went out as usual to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. Reaching the place, he said to them, pray that you will not fall into temptation. He withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them, knelt down and prayed, Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done. An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. When he rose from prayer and went back to the disciples, he found them asleep, exhausted from sorrow. Why are you sleeping? He asked. Get up and pray that you will not fall into temptation. Verse 47. While he was still speaking, a crowd came up, and a man who was called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He approached Jesus to kiss him, but Jesus asked him, Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss? When Jesus' followers saw what was going to happen, they said, Lord, should we strike with our swords? And one of them struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his right ear. But Jesus answered, no more of this. And he touched the man's ear and healed him. Then Jesus said to the chief priests, the officers of the temple guard, and the elders who had come for him, am I leading a rebellion that you have come with swords and clubs? Every day I was with you in the temple courts, and you did not lay a hand on me. But this is your hour when darkness reigns. Verse 54. Then seizing him, they led him away and took him into the house of the high priest. Peter followed at a distance. And when some there had kindled the fire in the middle of the courtyard and had sat down together, Peter sat down with them. A servant girl saw him seated there in the firelight. She looked closely at him and said, this man was with him. But he denied it. Woman, I don't know him. A little later, someone else saw him and said, you also are one of them. Man, I am not, Peter replied. About an hour later, another asserted, certainly this fellow was with him, for he is a Galilean. Peter replied, man, I don't know what you're talking about. Just as he was speaking, the rooster crowed. The Lord turned and looked straight at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word the Lord had spoken to him. before the rooster crows today, you will disown me 3 times. And he went outside and wept bitterly. The men who were guarding Jesus began mocking and beating him. They blindfolded him and demanded, "Prophesy, who hit you?" And they said many other insulting things to him. Verse 66. At daybreak, the council of the elders of the people, both the chief priests and the teachers of the law, met together, and Jesus was led before them. "If you are the Messiah," they said, "tell us." Jesus answered, "If I tell you, you will not believe me. And if I asked you, you would not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the mighty God." They all asked, "Are you then the Son of God?" He replied, "You say that I am." Then they said, "Why do we need any more testimony? We have heard it from his own lips." Chapter 23, verse 1 says, "Then the whole assembly rose and led him off to Pilate. And they began to accuse him, saying, 'We have found this man subverting our nation. He opposes payment of taxes to Caesar and claims to be the Messiah, a king.' So Pilate asked Jesus, 'Are you the king of the Jews?' 'You have said so,' Jesus replied. Then Pilate announced to the chief priests and the crowd, 'I find no basis for a charge against this man.' But they insisted, 'He stirs up the people all over Judea by his teaching. He started in Galilee and has come all the way here.'" Verse 6. On hearing this, Pilate asked the man was a Galilean. When he learned that Jesus was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem at that time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was greatly pleased, because for a long time he had been wanting to see him. From what he had heard about him, he hoped to see him perform a sign of some sort. He plied him with many questions, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and the teachers of the law were standing there vehemently accusing him. Then Herod and his soldiers ridiculed and mocked him, dressing him in an elegant robe. They sent him back to Pilate. That day, Herod and Pilate became friends. Before this, they had been enemies. Pilate called together the chief priests, the rulers of the people, and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was inciting the people to rebellion. I have examined him in your presence and have found no basis for your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us. As you can see, he has done nothing to deserve death. Therefore, I will punish him and then release him." But the whole crowd shouted, "Away with this man! Release Barabbas to us!" Barabbas had been thrown in prison for an insurrection in his city and for murder. Wanting to release Jesus, Pilate appealed to them again, but they kept shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" For the third time he spoke to them, "Why? What crime has this man committed? I have found in him no grounds for the death penalty. Therefore I will have him punished and then release him." But with loud shouts they insistently demanded that he be crucified, and their shouts prevailed. So Pilate decided to grant their demand. He released the man who had been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder, the one they had asked for, and surrendered Jesus to their will. As the soldiers led him away, they seized Simon from Cyrene, who was on his way in from the country, and put the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A large number of people followed him, including women who mourned and wailed for him. Jesus turned and said to them, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep for yourselves and for your children. For the time will come when you will say, 'Blessed are the childless women, the wombs that never bore and the breasts that have never nursed. Then they will say to the mountains, fall on us, and to the hills, cover us. For if people do these things when the tree is green, what will happen when it is dry? Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there, along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, he saved others, let him save himself if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one. The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, if you are the king of the Jews, save yourself. There was written a notice above him which read, this is the king of the Jews. One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us. But the other criminal rebuked him. Don't you fear God, he said, since you are under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve, but this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus answered him, truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. The sun stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. When he had said this, he breathed his last. The centurion, seeing what had happened, praised God and said, surely this was a righteous man. When all the people had gathered to witness this sight, saw what took place, they beat their breasts and went away. But all those who knew him, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance watching these things. Now there was a man named Joseph, a member of the council, a good and upright man, who had not consented to their decision and action. He came from the Judean town of Arimathea, and he himself was waiting for the kingdom of God. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body. Then he took it down, wrapped it in linen cloth, and placed it in a tomb cut in a rock, one in which no one had yet been laid. It was preparation day, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The women who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph and saw the tomb and how his body was laid in it. Then they went home, prepared spices and perfumes, but they rested on the Sabbath in obedience to the commandment. Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from my cries of anguish? My God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer. By night, but I find no rest. Yet you are enthroned as the Holy One. You are the one Israel praises. In you our ancestors put their trust. They trusted and delivered you. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried out and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by everyone, despised by the people. All who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts in the Lord, they say. Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. Yet you brought me out of the womb. You made me trust in you. Even at my mother's breast, from birth I was cast on you. From my mother's womb you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. Many bulls surround me, strong bulls of Bashan encircle me. Roaring lions that tear their prey open their mouths wide against me. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart has turned to wax. It has melted within me. My mouth is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You lay me in the dust of death. Dogs surround me. A pack of villains encircles me. They pierce my hands and my feet. All my bones are on display. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among them and cast lots for my garment. But you, Lord, do not be far from me. You are my strength. Come quickly to help me. Deliver me from the sword, my precious life from the power of the dogs. Rescue me from the mouth of the lions. Save me from the horns of the wild oxen. As we leave here tonight, contemplate these words, meditate on these words. I want you to think back to 2,000 years ago when Jesus' followers, they deserted him. His followers doubted him. Suddenly, this Messiah they had, he was our Savior. He was God's Son. He was going to lead us. And now he's dead. And now he's dead. They forgot the rest of the story. They forgot what Jesus said. And some of them just never, ever got it. And tonight I ask you, as you leave in silence, that you would go home, and I would ask you, because I contend that most people don't do this. Go home and contemplate, what did Jesus just do for us? What did he just do for us? They call this Good Friday, but why do they call it Good Friday? Yeah, I get it. Jesus did rise again, but they didn't know that. It wasn't called Good Friday then, but it was during their celebrations. Jesus should have shined during this time, and instead he was crucified. I want you to think about some what ifs when you go home. What if God said, they can't figure it out on their own, I'm not sending my son? What if Jesus had said, you know, Dad? No, I just don't know, man. No. They're constantly turning to the other gods. It's never going to change. No, I don't think so, Dad. I don't want to waste my death for them. What if Jesus had decided, you know what? I'm on this cross and I'm showing them. They don't understand. They haven't understood for the last 3.5 years. They still don't understand. They still don't get it. But I'm up here on this cross, and these guys down here are saying, oh, if you're God's son, save yourself. If you're king of the Jews, if you're this Messiah, save yourself. Well, maybe I will. And he would have pulled himself off that cross. What if he had pulled himself off that cross and said, guess what? We're not going to defeat death. We're not going to defeat Satan. We're not going to defeat sin. Instead, I'm going to show him another miracle, and maybe these ones will kind of figure it out. What if Jesus had never, he died on that cross, yet he never came out of that grave? What if he didn't leave the tomb? What if? See, 2,000 years ago, they were thinking, what if? And I believe we take it way too lightly. We don't understand the what if. We don't get it. We don't get it. So tonight, I encourage you. See, what they did is tonight, tomorrow on the Sabbath, their Sabbath wasn't a joyful, let's celebrate Sabbath. Their Sabbath was, what just happened? The rug's been pulled out from under us. Wait a minute. What if? So as you go home this weekend, don't go home this weekend just for a party. Don't just celebrate this weekend because you're going to get to see some family maybe you haven't seen for a while. Don't celebrate it just because of a big meal. Go home tonight and think about what if. God bless. I love you. We'll see you Sunday morning when he is risen.